Hello, this is the hatchetjob.com gaming netcast with the second, I think it's the second, in our series called WalkyTalky. And I'm here with Higgledy.
Hi.
Salutes. And WalkyTalky is a video series about walking in video games. And Higgledy is a walker and a rambler, and he leads walking and rambling parties. And so as we walk around this game, we're going to discuss what he's been up to and rambling in general, because it's something that I'm interested in, but not anything I've ever done. So, Higgledy, before we get onto that, what kind of route have you chosen for us today?
Right. Well, I thought we could head sort of northwards. I thought it'd be quite nice to start from where we left off. That wasn't ever the plan before, but it just suddenly occurred to me nice to start from here and then head up north. And see what we can find. So it's a bit sort of a little bit looser. I have sort of no part of this route.
Okay.
But I think we can sort of make it up as we go along, which you shouldn't really do. It's frowned upon in rambling circles.
Yeah. In rambling, you'd actually pick your route beforehand, which is kind of what we discussed in the last show.
That's it.
That's an interesting gun. That's another thing you don't hear on rambling. Look at that magazine.
Yes, I like your gun. Yes, that's it.
So
you shot many cows with it.
Yeah. So in the last show, we set things on fire and we talked about what rambling was. You should go back and listen to that if people want to find out what that's all about. But what was your kind of first rambling experience? We know that you wanted to lose a bit of weight, but what was your first experience? What happened when you kind of got to the group in the wilderness?
Right. I'm trying to think, because I have had an experience of a ramble that was earlier than that, which was when I was in the Scouts.
Right.
And we were supposed to go on a hike, and that's quite interesting.
Go on then.
Should we wingsuit off here?
Yes, please. Please do.
Right.
You should always go first so I can film you. It's left button in.
Oh, I did it. Good. Always a bit exciting when you hit it. You don't want to, not good to plummet to your death.
No.
So, right, yeah, so I was in the Scouts and we were supposed to go on a hike and sort of organise, very similar to a ramble, you organise the hike and plan it out on the map and then you, pagan wrath convoy up there, and so I did all that.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness, I forgot we had enemies in this.
Oh, he's a big man.
He's
a
big
guy,
man.
Higgledy. Is he dead? Is that one
he's
dead?
He's dead.
Nice.
And Honey Badger's getting the other guy.
Okay.
Okay.
Honey Badger would be a good stripper name, incidentally.
It would.
Yeah. Did your scoutmaster ever take you on to strip clubs?
No. Very rarely. we never got our strip club badge.
No. Well done, lads, for your walk in the North Wales. Let's get you a lap dance.
Yes.
Thanks, Scoutmaster. So in the Scouts.
In the Scouts, and we were supposed to do. I forget how far it was, but it was a hell of a long way as far as I was concerned.
Yes.
But that doesn't mean that it was necessarily a lot, but it felt like a hell of a long way. The one mistake I made was having an old map. I think map was something, had been made something like 1963 or 1965.
Yeah.
And this was probably at least 10 years later.
Right.
So we set off on our hike, and we soon started finding that there were sort of walls and barriers and things in our way that we hadn't really expected. And the clincher came when we sort of came over a hill and found a motorway that wasn't actually featured on the map.
Right.
So that was a slight
So how did you cross
problem.
It?
Well, and this is the point where I say, advise people, never do this. We actually ran across it. With rucksacks and everything. Just two of us. And cars in those days were quite slow. There weren't as many of them.
I don't understand. It was only two people on your hike. You and the scoutmaster.
Yeah, there was me. No, me and this other scout who was equally clueless. Not that. I was clueless.
So I'm getting confused. It was you and a scoutmaster. That's not a hike. That's a kidnapping. First of all,
Yeah, that's it. No, the Scoutmaster. You invented the Scoutmaster when we did the stripping thing. Yeah, the Scoutmaster wasn't involved. He'd sort of said, "Go on, off you go, lads," as you did in those days. You
oh, sorry.
Sort of
So,
no
so
health and
this.
safety.
So when you said you were the scouts, I assumed it was you and a group of them. But this is what your Scoutmaster just said. Go
off
for a
you
walk.
Go. Yeah,
really.
That's it.
Oh.
I always think it's funny. I always think when I think of scouts and health and safety, I always think of a black and white photograph of a scout, and he's tied to a plank,
yeah,
head to toe, tied with ropes, and they're hauling him up the side of a building. And I always think that's brilliant. They would never allow that in these days, would they?
Sorry, what was the context?
The scouts on the
for bondage scouts, bondage abseiling. What's the context about that?
Yeah. Well, it's just sort of, I suppose it's, you know, it's being inventive. It's sort of dealing with practical problems. Like, we've got this scout tied to a plank. How can we get him onto the, where are you?
Are you sure
I can't see, there you are.
I'm here. Are you sure they weren't luring him off the building in an emergency?
Well, because, they may have been. That's true. That probably makes more sense.
Yeah, I think tying a child to a plank and then dragging him up the outside of a building.
Called roofing. Let's do a bit of roofing. Who's up for being tied to a plank? So there's that, and there was British Bulldog. I don't know if you ever played British Bulldog.
You better remind people what British Bulldog is.
Well, it's the best name for a game ever, I think.
It is.
But basically, you have one guy in the middle. There's like two sides, so there's two safe zones, perhaps a bit like dodgeball.
Right.
And then there's a middle area, which is the danger zone, and there's one or two or three scouts in that danger zone. And you've got to run across, backwards and forwards across the danger zone, and their job is to pick you up. So if they manage to lift you off the floor...
Yeah.
Then you become one of the guys in the middle, and you're trying to catch and lift up the guys who are running by.
I don't remember. So it's kind of like group tag, where you have to tag one of the other people, kind of thing. But sort of. But I don't. When I played British Bulldog. You're supposed to die. Sorry, I wanted to kill. When I played British Bulldog, I don't recall there being a grabbing element. I thought it was just touch-based. Maybe this is in the 70s.
Well, this is probably Northern, or British Bulldog League rather than what's the other one?
Union.
Probably Northern Rules.
Northern Rules.
Rather than Union, yeah, that's it.
So
probably no punching in your version either.
No, so you talked about how you ran across this motorway when you were a scout with another scout. When I was at university, some friends took turns... decided to run across four dual carriageways.
Yeah.
And I kind of said, okay, thanks. Which maybe I should have done. But afterwards I found out that my friends were tripping off their tits on mushrooms when they did it.
Oh my goodness.
So, and it was at night, so they just saw all these kind of weird glowing shapes rumbling towards them. Are we wingsuiting down here?
Oh, I was going to, but I slid. I didn't commit to the wingsuit.
Oh, no, and I committed to parachuting. Oh.
Although you still seem to be running. Oh, you've fallen over now.
I've fallen. So
you had a delayed death there.
I had a delayed death. So I forgot to start timing this as well, Higgledy, so that's a bit of annoying. So, we can't have it too long. We'll do it. So that was your first kind of unofficial rambling experience as a child.
Yeah.
What was your first one of this, the modern era of Higgledy ramming and walking?
Well, that was down in Kent, and I joined, as I say, I was putting on a bit of weight, so, and I didn't really want to do any sort of sports or anything.
Yeah.
So I joined a rambling group in Kent, and I think I've told you about, we organise a coach and go by coach to places. But down in Kent, we would say where the starting point was, say a railway station or something, and then we'd all drive there in our cars.
Right.
Park up, so there'd have to be enough parking.
Yes.
And then they'd lead the walk.
Yeah.
And really, it was quite straightforward. I think the only thing was, when you first start rambling, it seems it's very tiring on the legs.
Yes.
And I would get over 6 miles, I'd start thinking, oh, God. It'd just be constantly thinking, oh, can't we just arrive back to the start point?
Yeah.
I stopped enjoying it for about the last quarter.
Of the walk,
yeah. And I was just wanting to get back. But your stamina increases as you walk, and you can just sort of,
like in Oblivion,
just keep going until they say... Yes, that's true. Yeah, you see the little figures ticking up over people's heads.
And like in those games, the more you do something, the better you got. Was your rambling just hopping repeatedly across the landscape and casting spells down in Kent?
Yes, that's it. Yes, and sort of waving your sword ineffectually at people. there was one incident which was...
We have an incident.
Unusual. Yes, and I've just remembered this. We walked up a path that had been used by mountain bikers and people on motorbikes, you know, those dirt bikes.
Yeah.
So it was very rough and very cut up, and there were loose rocks everywhere.
Yeah.
And I got to the top, and by this stage I was getting familiar with all the people who were walking with me. And there's this one lady, and as she came up to the top...
Behind us.
Oh. As she came up to the top of the path we'd just sort of covered.
Yeah.
She half her face was in sort of shadow, and she looked very different. And I thought, you know how you look at somebody and you think, gosh, they in this light, you know, they look so different.
Yes.
And as she got closer,
sorry.
No, she'd not had a stroke. She'd fallen over and banged her face on a rock. And she was, her cheek was all swelling up, and she got a black eye as well. And I thought, oh, that would explain it.
I had a similar experience. Oh fuck! Are you down?
Oh, I'm down. I'm down in the boat.
Yeah, hold on. Oh my god!
Sure, the rubber will protect me.
I had a similar experience with a friend who he'd got drunk one night, and he was walking through this kind of forested bit of London, not London, but you know, kind of like a copse or something.
Yeah.
And he, as he was walking forward, he put his foot out and found there was no ground there, and tumbled down 6 feet or something like that.
Cool.
And he smashed up, like quite, like cut up and kind of bludgeoned the side of his face. And, he didn't want his mother to know. He didn't want his mother to know that he'd been drinking, so he told it was a tennis accident. What version of tennis you're playing to have that? I don't know. But anyway,
no.
Oh fuck. Oh sorry. I thought I'd fallen. Apologies for the swearing. But I went round to his house.
Yeah.
And oh god. Hold on. He opened the door.
Oh, you lower yourself and swing.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. He opened the door, and he kept the bad side of his face behind it. And this is, I didn't know what had happened to him at this point. And so he then revealed his face. One side was normal. One side was like all bruised and buggered up. And I just burst out laughing at him. And because I'm good like that. And then we watched a film together, and he was lying down on the sofa, and I was laughing again because he couldn't close his mouth. So he kept on drooling onto the sofa and had to keep on mopping it up. Yeah, I'm not very good at sympathy. Sympathy's not really my thing. Can I search your dead body? No, I can't. Can I shoot an arrow into your testicles?
Probably.
Yeah, I can, but I can't get that arrow back.
Ah, there you go. There's karma again.
That's a bit of a bugger.
I'm respawning before you perforate my testicles anymore.
Okay.
Right. So, let's see. Oh.
So that was so Kent was amusing because this woman hurt herself.
Yes, that's it.
Yeah.
It was tricky, getting to the starts of walks and things, because Kent, the signposting in Kent, is weird because all the roads, so there's very, very old roads and sort of deep in the often raised banks, so you can't see anywhere other than down the road you're going down.
Yeah.
And the signposting was sort of designed for people who really knew where the village was.
Yes.
So they would signpost it so far, and then they probably thought, oh, well, he knows where it is from here. You know,
this
everybody
is a local
knows where
place
it is now.
For local
so we'll
people
stop
sort of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So we'll stop signposting it.
Yeah.
So then you'd get sort of lost, you know. So I would sometimes arrive 5 minutes or 10 minutes late for the start of the ramble.
Right.
And then, of course, you might as well be an hour late because you have no idea where they are.
Yeah, yeah. That's good. They ran over this little fox for me.
They did.
So that was that was Kent.
Yeah.
But your most recent ramble, or not? Yeah, is it your most recent one in the Llandudno?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Was in the Llandudno. So.
Yeah.
Which is Llandudno. It's Wales.
Yes.
So it sounds kind of like Elvish, I suppose. Probably Tolkien, I'm sure, got some inspiration from Welsh and Irish and so on. So what is Llandudno and where is Llandudno?
It's north on the coast of North Wales.
Yeah.
I'll probably pronounce it wrong. And
so this is the west of the west of Great Britain.
Yeah, yeah. On the did we describe Wales before? I'm not sure if I did.
No, I don't think you've described Wales.
Okay, so if you imagine England, there's like down bottom left, there's a foot coming out, which is mostly Cornwall. And then above that, there's a koala bear's head on its side.
Right.
And that's Wales.
Okay.
So
I've never heard
Llandudno,
it described like that. Yeah.
No. Well, I was thinking cat's head, but when you look at it, it's more like a koala bear. And then Llandudno is up near that top ear.
Right. Sorry, somebody tried to run me over, so I had to kill some civilians. Carry on.
Yes, often happens.
Yeah.
And rules of the road and all
yes,
that.
Yes, absolutely.
And it's just like a seaside resort. And a very old and very historic seaside resort. One of these places where people used to go to promenade in long dresses and Victorian era and all that. And the beauty of the place is that it still looks like that. It's almost more weird that people are there in modern clothing than if you went there and everybody was in Victorian garb. Yeah, it's absolutely beautiful place. And it has its own atmosphere. It has a specific atmosphere. It's not, you know, a lot of seaside resorts deteriorate and have that sort of worn down, slightly useless feel to them.
Yes. Apologies to anybody watching who might live in a seaside town.
Yes. Yeah. I'm sure yours doesn't, wherever you are. And this is sort of vibrant. I mean, there's cheap and tacky shops. There's always cheap and tacky shops.
Yeah.
But it's a really fantastic place. I love it.
I will.
So it's nice to walk there.
I've got some kind of bug where I can't sell anything, I think.
Oh.
Oh, fuck. We'll have to sort that out later. Get back, Higgledy. There's a grenade coming in.
Oh. Where did he come from?
I don't know. I've got a fact about Llandudno, though.
Yes.
From the View Britain website.
Mm-hmm.
It has a history linking back to the Bronze Age. A great Orm. Is that part of Llandudno? It must be. Houses approximately 4 miles of man-made tunnels, some of which are nearly 4,000 years old. Llandudno had the largest copper mine in Europe, and there's evidence suggests that it might even have been dug by small children due to the size of the tunnels.
Oh, gosh.
There you go.
I know there is, up on the Great Orm, there is a copper mine up there.
What is the Great... Is that a hill, the Great Orm?
I used to think that it was. There are these promontories that stick out. They're sort of rounded promontories sticking out into the sea.
Yes.
And I used to think that the Orm was just the promontory, but apparently it's all the land behind it.
Okay.
So it's sort of a raised landmass.
Right.
With farms and a church on there, and who's that over there?
They
have a long pier as well.
Okay. So, and now, is that bad guys or good guys? Now, you sent me some photos of your time in Hand in Gnome.
Yeah.
There were two photos. One was this very grey day with the wind clearly coming down on the beach with people in their cagoules and waterproofs. And it didn't look very pleasant. And then in the background was an ice cream van. And you said that you were rather hopeful. So did you have an ice cream, Higgledy, on your ramble?
That was a Landulus that walk. Sorry, I should have explained. So that was the Landulus walk, which shall forever be known as the Rain and Wind walk.
Right.
So that's near Landudno.
Right.
But not actually at Landudno. Well, and we didn't have an ice cream.
No. For the go on.
Yeah, when I captioned it for the Rambling website, I said the Sea Party deciding whether to have an ice cream before or after they go for a paddle.
Yes, but it looked pretty. I mean, if that, I would not use that on your Rambling website to advertise your Rambling, to go and stand on a very grey beach in the rain with an ice cream van behind you. And then the other photo, and was of this kind of tree-lined path with maybe blue and purple little flowers. Some walkers walking up the path, and two large wooden, almost bronze-looking sculptures of Tweedledum and Tweedledee.
Yes.
From Alice in Wonderland. So where was that, and what's the significance of that?
That is sort of that was the posh area around Landudno. There are some very huge houses around there, and obviously people with a ton of money.
Yeah.
And it's on the sort of the far side from Landudno itself of the Great Orm. And that seemed to be sort of a promenading sort of area. And yes, they're all over Landudno. We saw the White Rabbit, a sculpture of the White Rabbit.
So what
of the Cheshire Cat. I don't actually know what Lewis Carroll's connection is with Landudno.
Okay.
Right,
I better look that up now then, because
right.
I was hoping you'd be able to tell me. you're not a very good tour guide. This is from a book.
I'm not.
I don't know why it's here.
People ask me when I'm leading rambles.
Yeah.
People say, what's this? What's this mine? I said, I don't know.
Okay.
They say, well, you could have made something up. I said, I'll do that next time.
Oh, Alice in Wonderland, Llandudno was the holiday destination. Oh, my iPad 1 is having great, great problems. Too many redirects occurred.
Too many redirects.
So I'm looking at the St. Tudno Hotel and Restaurant website. I don't know who this is. So I think that Alice, the real Alice, must have gone to Llandudno as a kid, maybe.
Right.
So this hotel's connection with the books began with Alice Liddell, the inspiration for the Alice character, stayed in Llandudno in 1861. She was 8 years old and on holiday with her family when Charles Lutwidge Dodson, Lewis Carroll, visited the family.
So that could be the starting point.
Yeah, this is the website is, if you want to go look this up, www.st-tudno.co.uk.
Right. Not the most.
And her parents honeymooned in Llandudno.
You could jump into this boat if I bring it under the bridge.
Under the bridge? Yes, okay, I'll jump into the boat. So that's why. So it must have been the Victorians with the trains, because of course it was the railways that... Well, the railways really opened up holidays for everybody in Britain, but especially kind of the working class. They used to get onto their trains, and then of course when flights came along, and you know, cheap flights, and that's there's a bigger boat behind you, Higgledy. I want this one.
Right.
Oh, I fucked it up. Never mind. I'm coming up. I'll go and jump in again. But basically, yeah. So. When the opportunity arose for people in Great Britain to go to hotter countries on holiday rather than our coastal towns. They took that opportunity. And it kind of left these towns in disarray to some degree.
Yeah.
Because not only were they seasonal businesses, you know, people only come when it's hot. Those businesses then saw an even greater decline when people started going to Spain. Oh, I copped it up again. Never mind. I'm just going to swim. I'm drowning, Higgledy. And something's shooting at me.
Where are you?
I'm here.
You're swimming up. Whoa.
I'm in now. I'm in. Oh. I'm safe.
You sort of span into the boat.
I breakdanced into the boat.
Yeah, I'll have to show you that because that was quite amazing. You sort of swam up the side of the boat.
Yes.
And then you sort of span round for 30 seconds on the spot with your legs in the air.
That's great. So what was what was the composition of your group in Llandudno for this walk?
There was 20... That was interesting. There were 28 of us on the sea walk, which is an unusually high number. And there were about 8 on the B walk. And,
so the C walk is the slowest, the B is the medium, and the A is the fastest.
Yeah, and my theory is that people sort of fancied having a look round Llandudno, so they sort of stayed with that walk.
Right.
And it was very nice. It was very nice. Whoa.
I think we should take a bigger boat.
A bigger boat.
Yeah, we need a bigger boat.
Yes, probably.
In the words of Jaws.
This one's blue, though. That's always a good thing.
Right. No. Go on. Carnage. Go on. No, I don't want to kick him to death. I'm trying to get him to piss off. Oh, I killed him. Never mind.
Oh, hang on. Climb. That's it.
So you had a large group for this walk. Yeah?
Yes, yeah. And that can always be a bit of a problem because the more people you have, the more people you have got to get over stiles and things. And it can really slow you down. And you can all get spread out as well, which isn't good.
From the pictures I saw that you sent me, I would have thought that the walk, this one was kind of... like a seaside walk along the pier, or it was actually, you did actually go to the countryside, if you're talking about style.
We did, yeah. What we did, we walked along the prom, which was sort of a wide promenading area in front of the sea, not actually down on the beach.
Yes.
Can we climb up here?
Well, I want to see if we can swim underneath. Oh, something is biting me. There's some kind of big
I'm
fish
a bit low.
Biting me.
Oh.
I'm just going to use my... Where are you? Are you? I'm going to try and swim in the waterfall, Higgledy.
Okay. Do you think there's like a... I don't know if there's a passage under there or not.
Well, I'll see. I hope there is. Yes, there is.
Is there?
Yeah, I don't know where it goes. So let's... Do you have any underwater syringe?
Oh. Probably. I can work out which one it is. Or can I not do it underwater?
No, you can't make syringes underwater.
Oh.
Right, so come out.
Yes. Oh, I'm terrible in caves. Oh, heck. Now then. I can't see where I am.
Follow me up.
Hang on. Oh, I'm breathing. Okay. So, you are... Ah, got you. So can we climb out of here?
Yeah, I think so. Like it. I'm getting, excuse me. There's a grapple piece. Or maybe it's just showing through the rock.
I think it is. I had a cultural experience, not necessarily in Llandudno, but I could tell you about that.
Yes, go ahead. Please share your cultural experience.
Okay. So, this was the Llandullus walk again.
Yes.
So, we'd finished the walk, and we were all drying off,
Yes.
and we were in the
What,
pub,
drying?
and
Sorry, because I'm swimming, I just imagined you all
yeah.
naked toweling off after your walk, which of course
Oh,
is
right.
not going to.
Clothes over chairs and things.
Yeah, it's not going to
No,
be like that,
no.
is it? No.
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 Ah, we can get up there, yes. Can you see that? Yeah.
Yeah.
So there was a guy in front of me at the bar,
Yeah.
and he said to the barman, "I'd like a pickled egg inside a packet of ready salted crisps, please." And it's one of those things where you think, now I heard that, but I can't have heard that right, surely to goodness. So I sort of watched the barman, and
Yeah.
he turned round, opened a jar of big pickled eggs,
Yes.
and then put one of these pickled eggs inside a packet of ready salted crisps.
Oh,
And
right.
the chap went outside, and I've actually got the photograph
Yeah.
of a surreptitious photograph of him, and I can see into the packet of crisps and
You
see the pickled egg.
can see into the packet of crisps. I'm gonna turn
Yeah,
the
he
brightness
had
up a
them
bit.
sort of. Oh, yeah, then. Oh,
Sorry if it's
see a bit
been
here.
too dark for anybody watching. It's hard to know what kind of brightness you need. So over here, I mean, it's not too many pubs that really sell pickled eggs. It's more fish and chip shops in
No.
London.
Have you eaten a lot of pickled eggs?
Not recently. I mean, I've had one in the
I'd
past, but
never had pickled eggs.
hold on one moment, Higgledy. I need to describe how these
Yeah.
pickled eggs. So. The pickled eggs are just in these huge, enormous kind of either glass or plastic jars with a screw top lid,
Yeah.
and
Yeah.
they're in the pickle juice, the pickling liquid. And it doesn't sound entirely pleasant when I'm saying it like this, does it? And you do ask for a pickled
Well,
egg. But the thing that got me, Higgledy, about your story is the
yes.
fact that he. How do I climb up here? It's the fact
Oh, there's another.
he asked the
Yeah.
man. It's the fact that the punter asked the barman to open up the packet of crisps and put the egg in there
Yeah.
for him. That's the
Yeah.
really weird bit. Instead of just saying, "Can I
It
have a pickled
is.
egg, please?"
And I've been thinking since then. Is he just one guy, and the
Yeah.
barman thinks, "Oh, it's that bugger who keeps asking me to put pickled eggs in his crisps," or is it like a traditional thing, you know? And like he almost could have just said, "Give me a pickled egg," and he might have replied, "Oh, should I put that in a packet of ready salted crisps for you?" So it could either be this guy's a one-off, or
Yeah.
it's like a traditional in that part of the country, and the barman didn't bat an eyelid.
But I can
I've since
actually.
eaten a pickled egg.
Yes, go on.
Go on.
Go on, no. Well, I just want to
Yeah.
know, did you see the man eat this?
Well, I didn't actually see, because you don't want to stare too much,
No.
but
At the nutter with his pickled eggs and the
I didn't
packet of
actually see
crisps.
him bite. No, that's it. I didn't actually see him biting into it, but I
Yes.
did see the egg in the crisps, and
Right.
there was a bite out of it. So,
See, because I'm wondering now, Higgledy. So,
yes.
first of all, you talk about your pickled egg, and describe the sensation of eating it, and then we'll go back to this incident. An
Right,
incident is the
okay.
only way it can be described, I think.
Yeah. So I thought, right, I've never eaten a pickled egg, so I do like pickles, that's the thing.
Right.
And
This is gloriously boring.
yeah, well,
In,
that's it.
yeah.
And I do like boiled eggs. So I
Yes,
thought a
what?
pickled boiled egg, you know, may be the
Yeah.
answer to my prayers. So
Take cover. Yeah.
I had one, and it's nice, but it struck me that it's like two experiences at once
Right.
that are, although both pleasant, somehow shouldn't be together. It occurred to me, an analogy occurred to me. It's a bit like having a foot rub while eating a good book, reading a good book.
While eating a good
Both,
book,
yeah. On a soft, yeah.
get me up? Because those
So,
that
oh,
convoy
I thought I
managed to
had.
shoot my landmine.
Oh, the cunning devils. Oh,
I'm gonna get behind them or try to.
gosh, they're good, aren't they?
Yeah, you stay. You distract them, and I'm getting up behind them.
Right.
So, what did the pickled egg taste like? Can you recall the sense memory?
Well, yeah, it's all pickly and sharp,
Yeah.
but then there's the this is get, stop me if this is getting too technical, but then
Yeah.
it's very eggy in the middle.
Okay, I'm getting it. Are you dead?
Oh, I'm down there.
Oh, fuck.
I'm down, so you carry on and...
No, I'm coming around to get you. Crawl into cover.
This is possibly the toughest convoy we've ever faced.
It's because they're not coming towards us. You see, what I'm wondering, Higgledy...
No.
...is did this man... So you take this pickled egg, which is wet and soft, and you put it in a packet of crisps, which are hard.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's salt and vinegary, you know, in a way that chips are salt and vinegary.
Yeah. Now, the question is, did he... You stay in cover, Higgledy, I'll go behind them.
Right.
One has died. Maybe they shot themselves. Did he... can I do this? Did he take individual crisps out?
You're making me wish I'd watched him now.
Yeah. Yes. So it's like, did he put the egg in and then flavour the crisps? Or did he take the egg out that was covered in crisps? Or did he just put them both in together and just mash them together and then scoop the paste out into his mouth? That's kind of what I'm wondering.
I don't think he did that. Yes. I think that may be frowned upon, even in Derbyshire.
Maybe. He put the egg and the crisps together, mashed them up, and then turned the packet into a little tube and just squirted it into his maw.
Yes, that's it. Just started squeezing at the bottom end.
Yes.
Until the goo sort of spurted out the top end. Yeah. Oh, almost undoubtedly. That's almost the logical way to do it, really.
I think we should just stop recording now, because nothing's going to top that pickle egg story in this show. Have you tried that with him since? I'm going to try that now. I have to try that. I have to know what it's like.
Well, that's it. That's what happened to me. It's just haunted my dreams. I thought, well, I've got to try a pickled egg.
I mean, that's some Heston Blumenthal level shit when he's combining ingredients like that.
It is. That's it. And on the fly, you know, it's not sort of, I'm a master chef. I'm just, it's almost sort of, what's that guy's name? MacGyver. MacGyver.
MacGyver, yeah.
It's MacGyver-esque, isn't it?
It's sort of
cordon bleu, only made out of what you find in a pub.
We're being shot by our own men. Run away.
Really?
Yeah, the Golden Path are after me because I blew up a small car. So this was after your walk or during or pre?
Just after the walk, after the walk. We were sort of settling back and relaxing, and then this disturbing event happened. So now then.
Okay. So let's just walk in silence for a few minutes to let that sink in.
Right.
Yeah. Not totally in silence, because people watching this are going to be extremely bored, but...
So we've actually ended up back on the other side of the bridge, so we can make our way up north again. This is quite an interesting way to do walks, because on normal walks you don't respawn back several miles
and have to
do the same bit again. Ooh. I had a bit of a delay there.
Yeah, it happens occasionally. It stutters.
Yeah.
So I've got actually talking about respawning, right, and the idea of you're finding the game is too difficult and you come back in. Have you ever had to pick somebody up on a walk with a vehicle? So it's like they get halfway through and they're kind of saying, I've hurt my ankle or I'm not feeling very well. How would you deal with a situation like that?
Well, that's always worries me.
leave them by the roadside.
Yeah, that's it. Here, we found you a Mars bar and half a Kindle meat cake. We'll pick you up when we finish the ramble.
God be with you. It's like something out of Lord of the Rings with Boromir.
Yeah. We did. There was a lady who fell over on a beach walk and broke her shoulder blade, and we had to call in people to... They're both dead. Yeah, they are now. Oh!
Yeah. How did she... fell over on a beach, or she was on shingle or something, or what?
Yeah, they were on a beach heading out to some island or other, Saint something or other, and she slipped on a rock and just fell backwards, and she must have just got a rock in the wrong place. And then they I think actually, I think there was a guy.
Oh, he's running away from the grenade.
There were some guys passing at the time, and they called in a Land Rover.
Gosh.
And apparently, it was a very uncomfortable ride in this Land Rover back to the hospital.
What they called in an emergency rescue Land Rover, or they just had a pal with the Land Rover.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
I'm a bit vague on it, but there was either a guy there who knew the rescue people, or they were nearby in the Land Rover and they were able to whisk her off. So that was lucky, really, because that's always the big worry: is what the hell do you do if you've got someone who's injured? We did. Sometimes if someone can walk, you'll send someone back with that person. We've got one lady who's a lovely older lady, but she sets off and walks. She shouldn't really go on.
Right.
And then she'll say, "Oh, I'm having a bit of trouble here on halfway up this hill." So then you have to send her off with somebody, which sort of shortens their walk.
So the question then is, I mean, this is, you know, this applies to all sorts of things. It applies to walking, it applies to games with friends, or, you know, like multiplayer games. What do you do when you have somebody? How do you handle it when you have somebody who, they want to take part at a level that's probably a bit too advanced for them? How do you handle that? Because her enthusiasm is also kind of making the group a bit uneasy, or is kind of spoiling somebody's day a bit.
It's okay if she can do it and tough it out and then say, okay, I'm not going to go on the next B walk, I'm going to cut down to the C walk.
Yeah.
But if she keeps going on these walks, you know, I think if it happens once or even twice, you can think, oh, well, she made a mistake, you know, she misjudged it. And she'd really love to go on these B walks, but she's not up to it, you know. No problem. But if she just keeps, which is what she's doing, she keeps coming on these walks, and then every time somebody has to go back with her,
there's a bear behind
you. That's becoming unfair.
So how many times?
It's a stealth bear.
How many times this has happened?
Oh crap! I'm down. She's done it about 4 times, I think.
Right, and each time
I don't think she wears appropriate boots either, which doesn't help. And there's been an announcement that everybody should wear proper walking boots on their feet.
So how
she
old
wears
is this
wellies
woman?
And things.
How old is? Do you think
she must be about 80? She must be about 80.
So she's setting up in her Perspex stripper platforms.
Yeah.
Hobbling over the rock. That's really difficult, isn't it? Because at 80, you want them to keep being active. You want to encourage them to continue to be social because it's so important for their physical and mental health.
Yeah.
But then when you're 80 years old and you're obviously very strong-willed, kind of taking the advice, I mean, going to the, like, from the B middle group to the C slowest group is also sort of an admission about how well you're doing physically.
Yeah, which I suppose is a similar thing to people who don't want to leave their homes, you know, don't want to go into a care home or...
Yeah.
You know, it's very easy from the outside to think, oh, do it, you know, just do it. Just sort of admit that you need this and accept it. But from the perspective of the person themselves, you know, they've been able to do this all their lives, and now they just can't quite do it. And, you know, they could easily think, oh, just a bit more effort.
He screamed and then
fell out
dead.
I can keep doing this.
Yeah.
So there is a bit of understanding, but she also has to be fair to other people. You know, I think you've got to think of other people and not set off on a walk. I suppose that's it. Each time she must think, oh crap, you down? Yes.
No, I'm okay. No. I'm up. I've got another fact about Llandudno.
Go on.
Over 30 shipwreck remains can be found in the bay. One of the oldest is the Phoenix, and it was a warship that was wrecked in 1642.
Oh wow.
Yeah. So our wrecks are older than you, America. Take that.
Out in the Thames somewhere, there's a ship that's still loaded with explosives, and they've got it marked, but they daren't start messing with it. My dad went on a sailing ship not so long ago,
Yeah.
And they actually moored near this ship, sunken ship with all the explosive on. And because they sort of had to do it. And they were saying, you know, you've just got to rely on your luck that tonight's not the night when it goes up.
Yeah. I was in a flotilla of boats that went down the Thames once on a sunny day. It was very nice. I think we're probably coming up to... we've been here before,
Higgledy. Probably should have come down here.
We've been on this is the bench where we discussed the
pickled
egg. I was hoping
you wouldn't notice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, good walking skills there, boy. Well done for leading us.
Oh, that was good. He'll be no trouble.
I think
if
we're
we
coming
see
up...
Another...
We're going to be
yeah,
soon...
we're coming
we're going to be
back
coming
to...
Up... No, hold on, Higgledy. We're yeah. coming up towards an hour, I think.
Okay. Yes, I looted this crate. I'm having a sense of deja vu.
Okay, so you need to... Let's go into walk mode now. Where are we heading?
Okay. So up here, I think. Well, right. The problem is we got killed as we got into the north, so now right. we can go back into the north again and not get killed. And actually, we went up on the bridge last time, so we can go under the bridge this time. Oh, an actual eagle. Hang on.
I'm just wondering if maybe we should call this... What do you want? Do you want to call this for the moment? Because I think we're
yeah,
almost
we could do.
On an hour.
Yeah, and then we could sort of start it as we head up north.
Yeah, if we go on for another 5 or 6 minutes, because we don't want to...
Okay.
Have the, I mean, the walkie-talkie series, if you haven't caught the beginning, the walkie-talkie series is that we walk through a video game and we discuss walking in real life and rambling. But we're trying to find this balance, aren't we, Higgledy, between, you know, how long should the video be?
Yeah. We don't know whether to bore people in long... sessions yeah. or short chunks. Yeah, it's tricky because there's arguments for a long
This guy got in front of me in a firefight.
Oh yeah, they do that. I absolutely hate it when they do that. You're sort of shooting away at the enemy and then some guy runs in front of you.
Yeah. So before we forget, hold on a second. So, in case people are watching at the moment who haven't seen the whole video, this is being filmed for the HatchetJob.com podcast, and we're on Twitter, on YouTube, and all sorts. And Higgledy, you're on YouTube as well with the channel. Your
yeah.
channel is Tiber, TIBER.
Yeah.
But anyway, so what were you going to say? I've got that plug out of the way.
Okay. Ooh. Yeah, there was an old ruined theatre we
yes.
passed.
Okay.
There's a big, a grand hotel just above the pier, and behind that grand hotel, there's like an area that looks like an abandoned building site.
Yes.
You can actually see the sort of stubs of wrought ironwork, and apparently there was a very well-known theatre there, and it was just all demolished.
So, you say it looks like something from the Victorian era, and there are some posh houses there, but is it actually thriving, or is it kind of economically depressed? Because Wales isn't doing too well in some economic terms.
I think it's doing well. There are a lot of hotels and bed and breakfasts and places like that there.
Yeah.
And, the shops are very tacky and cheap. But, yeah, it has that look of somewhere that's actually doing okay.
Right.
I think it's different enough and unique enough that it's a great place to go. My parents go there for weekends and things.
Right.
And I know other people who go there for, you know, 3 or 4 days. And it's just a beautiful place. And the Orme, even though you don't know of it, the Orme is quite well known.
So...
And there's actually a little dry ski slope up there.
I suppose that one of the problems with these kind of seaside resorts is, and again, we're, you know, this series is not only going to be about walking, it's going to be about the places that you walk to. I suppose
yeah.
one of the problems about the seaside resorts perhaps is, how do you attract younger people? And then do you concentrate on families, or do you only kind of keep trying to attract people who have history of it? Because, like, How many people from London have gone to Llandudno? Like when I was a kid, when we went to the seaside, we went to Margate.
Yeah, and there is you do if you have somewhere
It's very pretty here, Higgledy, isn't
if
it?
you have
With
somewhere that it is rather,
the lights.
yeah, and the pigs.
Yep.
Yeah, the young people have almost got to decide for themselves, haven't they? You can only put on various sort of have certain shops and things there, and then I suppose the young people have just got to elect decide that it's cool, haven't they? You can't really sort of do much to
No.
persuade them.
There's
There's a bear
something.
up there. It looks like it can't make it down.
Where is it? I can't see it.
Up at the one end of this, it's at the end of this wooden bridge. There.
Yeah, I'm gonna try and set it on fire. Oh, he's ticked off, isn't he? I think he's legged it.
He is.
Yeah, he's. Oh, he's running away.
He's running. Okay. Yeah.
Is he
Oh,
coming
he looks like
down?
he's coming. Is he coming down?
No, he can't. There's no way. I can go up there though.
No.
Sorry,
You could.
I want to see what happens. On this bear attack, I think this might be an opportune moment to pause, Higgledy, because I think we have been recording for an hour
Right.
or near enough.
Well,
Bear jump.
the bear's going across the bridge.
Yeah, I'm playing
Cut
chicken
the
with him.
bridge. Cut the
Oh,
ropes.
he climbed on top of the
Oh.
ropes like a cat. He was walking along
Oh.
the side. Oh shit.
Oh. 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 What the hell? You sort of came down to ground level and then wingsuited up and then parachuted.
Well, that's
Very odd.
you might want to capture that for
I think I
posterity.
will. I'm going to have to show you these things because you won't believe me otherwise.
Okay, so I think
Well,
that's sorry,
yeah, this
Higgledy,
is great.
we better stop because it is an hour or so.
Sure.
So that's the second episode of Walkie Talkie. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe to the channel if you want to see more of them. And how do I do that? No, that's it's
No.
left and shut.
Down on the D-pad, and
And
then right stick. Yeah. Yeah. I think yours is stuck on that little
is.
bird.
It
Never
is.
seems to get any of the others.
No. Well, thank you very much for watching, and it's goodbye from me, and it's goodbye from Higgledy.
Yeah, bye.